Qualifying for the Australian Grand Prix is over, and it's a McLaren front row lockout as Lando Norris takes the first pole position of the year, and my prediction from yesterday about Charles Leclerc is immediately blowing up in my face. But what did we learn today? Well, in today's video, I'm going to be taking a look at the data and doing a data analysis from qualifying. If you enjoy the video, then please hit the like button and subscribe for more F1 content. Now, let's get into the video. As usual, I'll be talking about the top teams later on, so please do stick around for that. Yep, qualifying is over, and it is a front row lockout for McLaren, and Max Verstappen has recovered perfectly to be lining up in third place, showing what I have previously said. You can never count Max out. The midfield is looking incredibly close as well, and honestly, I am just glad F1 is officially back. The first qualifying session of the year took place under very warm conditions, as the air temperature was over 32 degrees at the beginning of the session, which is a complete opposite of what is expected for the Grand Prix on Sunday at Albert Park. And as usual, there was a lot of circuit evolution, which is what you can see here when you take a look at all of the lap times set by pole sitter Lando Norris in the McLaren. Let's now compare his first qualifying lap to his pole position lap time to see where the differences were as the circuit evolved during the session. When you look at this lap, you immediately can see through the first couple of corners how Lando Norris in Q3 has more grip and can attack the track a lot harder compared to his first run in Q1. Through turn 1 in Q1, Lando Norris carries a minimum apex speed of 188 km/h. But in Q3, Norris carries over 200 km/h, showing already how much more committed he is to attacking the track. You can also see that on the exit of turn 3 and turn 4, how Norris can very quickly get back up to speed as he has a lot more grip and a lot more traction. Not only that, but you can also see in Q3 how much more deployment Lando Norris is using compared to Q1, and that can be seen at the middle part of the lap, as Norris's top speed and acceleration is much more aggressive in the final qualifying lap, as he is using all of the performance available to the McLaren car. That being said, at some of the heavy stops, it looks as though Norris was actually slightly better in Q1. But that could have been because he was coming to the corners with slightly less aggression, leading to him maybe finding it easier to find some time. Overall, between the start of Q1 and the end of Q3, Lando Norris improved his lap time by 1 full second, and the pole position lap time from 2025 is 0.9 seconds faster than the pole position lap time from 2024. So we've seen how the times improved during the session, but let's now take a look at the top speeds that the teams were able to reach, and what can we see here? Well, what we can see is that actually the fastest car in a straight line was the Red Bull car, as Verstappen reached a top speed of 334 km/h, and this was very closely followed by the Racing Bulls, who reached a top speed of 333 km/h. McLaren and Ferrari looked like they could be the teams running with the most downforce, as both of them only reached 329 km/h, potentially showing that they are preparing more for a wet race than a dry race, whereas Verstappen and Red Bull are looking more towards a dry configuration. In general though, the majority of teams are either hitting 331 or 332 km/h in qualifying. Briefly, I want to talk about some of the rookies. Oliver Behrmann has had a very difficult start to life in F1, as the Haas driver crashed in FP1, he couldn't go out in FP2, then in FP3, he dropped the car into the gravel, and in qualifying, he had a gearbox failure, meaning that he is starting a potentially wet race in Melbourne with the least amount of practice possible at this circuit. As for Gabriel Bortoleto, it could not have been any more different for him, as he has impressed a lot of people, as he has not only out-qualified teammate Nico Hülkenberg on debut, but he also eliminated the Red Bull of Liam Lawson, and also the Mercedes of Kimi Antonelli. But we will be talking about Liam Lawson and Kimi Antonelli very shortly. I just want to say, if you are enjoying the video so far, then I would really appreciate it if you hit the like button and subscribe for more F1 content. Now though, let's get back to the video, and let's talk about Racing Bulls and Williams. For Racing Bulls then, it was an incredible start to the season, as Yuki Tsunoda is lining up in 5th place on the grid, and Alex Albon in the Williams is next to him in 6th place, and for both of these teams, they find themselves ahead of both Ferrari cars, and also Liam Lawson in the Red Bull, and Kimi Antonelli in the Mercedes. And let's be honest, for Yuki Tsunoda, he cannot be any happier about this, and probably is happy he didn't get the call to Red Bull. Because let's be honest, the Red Bull seat is a curse for anyone whose name is not Max Verstappen. But how did Tsunoda out-qualify Charles Leclerc in the Ferrari? Well, let's compare both of their Q3 lap times. And when you look at both of these laps, Charles Leclerc actually has the edge over Tsunoda for the majority of the lap. Leclerc in general was carrying more minimum apex speed and was later on the brakes. That being said, Tsunoda had more top speed at the middle portion of the lap, but Leclerc lost out in the last corner, as he looks to have potentially made a mistake, gone deep and got a bad exit from that final corner. For Racing Bulls, it looks like they've potentially opted for a bit less downforce, so if the race is wet, it will be interesting to see what they can actually do. For Mercedes then, it was a disaster day for Kimi Antonelli, as he was eliminated in the first part of qualifying, but it looks as though Antonelli suffered floor damage at the turn 6 corner as he ran wide. He didn't run as wide as some other drivers, however, it doesn't really matter, because this damaged his floor, and because of that, he ended up being eliminated from the first part of qualifying. Teammate George Russell, however, is lining up in 4th place on the grid, which he can be very happy about, as he is ahead of both Ferrari cars. Let's compare George Russell's lap to Lando Norris, so we can see where George lost out on pole position. When you look at these two laps, it looks as though Russell loses out against Norris on traction at a lot of the corners, as Lando Norris tends to get a better run on the exit of the corners. But also, at the fast chicane section here, Lando Norris carried 14 per hour more speed through there, as the McLaren was beautifully hooked up around the circuit. Then, on the exit of the final corner, Norris gets amazing traction, whereas George Russell's tyres might have just been starting to give up a little bit. For Mercedes in the race tomorrow, they will be hoping that it is a wet race, as really, the wet weather seems like it could be the only thing that stops McLaren and possibly helps a team like Mercedes. For Red Bull then, it was a very mixed bag day. Liam Lawson spent plenty of time off track, and Max Verstappen is in third place. And really for him, he is in a great place if the race is wet. Although, I am not sure if Red Bull has more of a dry setup compared to McLaren. And the reason I say that is because of the top speed that Red Bull reached compared to McLaren, and, well, it was a lot higher for them. When you compare Norris's lap to Verstappen, you can really see where it fell apart for Red Bull as well. As mentioned, the top speed of the Red Bull was higher, but look at Sector 3. Sector 3 features several heavy braking zones and slower 90 degree corners, and it is in those corners where Verstappen really loses out to Norris, showing that Red Bull is still the weaker car in the slower corners. But also, Verstappen was saying that his soft tyres were really starting to fade away by the end of the lap, and well, you can see that here as well, because he really does bleed time through those final couple of corners. For Red Bull and Verstappen though, they can still be very happy with this result, and they will be relying on Verstappen's ability in the wet for Sunday. For Liam Lawson, there is a ton of work to do, but it has to be said and reminded, Liam Lawson does have a different spec of a car to Max Verstappen this weekend. For Ferrari then, it was a bit of a disappointment kind of day. Let's be honest, I think there was a lot more expected from them, but there is a positive, and that is that they were able to use all tyres for a long time, showing that they have great tyre wear. But that tyre wear does not translate into one lap pace, and it looks like they lack grip early on, which could explain the spin for Lewis Hamilton. Between Leclerc and Hamilton, there is a 2/10 gap, but they are lining up next to each other on the grid. For Ferrari, the only hope is that they could be running with a bit more of a wet setup, which, if they are, could potentially bring them back into it tomorrow a little bit. And finally, for McLaren then, it was the perfect start to the season, as they are starting in 1st and 2nd place on the grid. Lando Norris just edged out Oscar Piastri to start on pole position, and also, McLaren looked to be running more downforce, which is ideal if the race is wet. they also have pretty much left the rest of the field for dead, at least based on the previous races. When you look at the gaps of both Norris and Piastri, there is very little to tell between them. But in general though, Piastri is later on the brakes, but Norris gets better exits from the corners, and it is the better exits that rewards Norris with pole position. For McLaren, they are looking very strong right now, and it is just a matter of if they can get the start right in the wet. If they do, then victory could be possible. So, that was qualifying. But the question is, what is going to happen in the race? Well, to be completely honest, if it's wet, I have absolutely no idea, and I'm very, very excited to find out. But the question is, what do you guys think will happen in the Grand Prix? In the comment section down below, please do let me know. And as always, comment, leave a like and subscribe for more F1 content. Thank you all so much for watching.